teens is a big product. And what we'll want to try to do is do a whistle stop tour of this, because we're not going to be able to go into everything in detail. Some people will have different preferences on what they're wanting to showcase here, what they're wanting to see. So we'll just cover a little bit of everything. From now on, you can see my screen. And as we said, we are recording this. So down the line, when we get back to this, you can actually see everything that I'm doing and everything that I'm seeing from my end, rather than just from your end as well. So let's just jump over to the chat here. Teams is more than just video calling. Obviously, with COVID and kind of working from offices, kind of working from home, some people working from home, shelter in places and places in the world, etc., still going on. I think video calling, video team meetings, everything like that is going to become so much more the standard of workplaces anyway, even if it's not all the time in your workplace, but interacting with other companies. I did forget to say, and Rich has just done it, sorry, let's do a little bit of housekeeping there. There is an option here to raise your hand, but because we've got a small amount of people, you can either speak up by unmuting, or there is a meeting chat, which is what you do if you get that button there. And if you get meeting chat, you can put a question in here, and we'll either try to answer it immediately, or we'll come back to it at the end and answer any questions that you have. Because it's half an hour, we probably will just treat them at the end. But Teams is obviously more than just a video call. We will talk at the end as well about where their pathway is and what they're doing to improve Teams, and maybe some of the other bits and pieces that are coming on board. So we'll show that. But let's show you the other bits of it as well, and we will get back to the video calls and the meetings shortly. But Teams is also your instant messaging. It's also your group messaging. It's also your file sharing option. It's all one place. It's persistent and consistent conversation, communication, audio, video calling, the lot. So we can see here that we're in chat. That's now coming up all the time at this. That's interesting. That's a new bit. I keep finding every time I come on to Teams that there's new bits. And this is one of the new bits that even when I'm on a meeting, and usually when I went to chat, this would disappear. But actually, I've still got this up and it's moved the chat down to here. So normally that would have been up here. That's quite a new, good new thing, because I can then sit and still do other work and kind of watch into a meeting. You're seeing what I can see at the minute. Here we've got messages. We've got instant messages between me and Andy. I'm going to go hi. Good morning. He mightn't respond because he said to us a little while ago that he's got IT issues. Being IT trainers, we always get IT issues. And we can send an instant message. That person can reply very, very quickly. If you think about what instant messaging is, it's WhatsApp, it's text messages, it's AIM, it's MSN Messenger, it's Skype messaging, it's way back there, it's anything like that. And that can be instant messages. Now, you can respond to these. So you can do it a thumbs up, a heart, happy face, etc. You can save these messages, mark them as unread, edit or delete them. So messaging, again, not much more to talk about on that part of it. However, down here, you've got a few things like you can set delivery options. So how important is the message? Does somebody get notified? You can attach files, which we'll come to in a minute. You can do emojis. You can do GIFs. You can do memes as well. You can arrange appointments. One of the other things you can do as well is you can format your messages before you send it. So if you click that little format button, you can bold, italics, underline, etc., and do all of that. And so you can put a more of a longer message in, because this allows for group messaging as well as one-to-one messages. The other good thing about doing the format button is if you want to do a multi-line message, because in Microsoft Teams, if you hit enter after you do the first part of your message on a chat, it will automatically send it. And that's a little bit irritating, because we're used to typing on an email, typing hi, comma, speak, enter, and that would actually send in a Teams chat. But if you do that, you can actually send a multi-line message, simple enough, and then you hit the send button. Up here at the top, we get the option to do a video call, an audio call, or share the screen with the person. Now, obviously, I'm sharing the screen at the minute, and I'll touch on that again later. But sharing screen allows you to collaborate on a document, collaborate on a Word or a project or your screen, or they can actually help, because they can take care of, take over your screen and help you some sort of IT. Andy has joined us eventually, so he has said hi. This button here allows us to pop out chat. That's only come about in about the last month. If I choose to pop out chat, this brings this chat out into a separate window. Again, this is really useful because historically with Teams, if you wanted to go between a chat and a team and a call, you would have to actually click between them, which means you're waiting for a reply for a message, but you're having to jump into Teams to go to one of the messenger or jump into a meeting. Now you can actually pop these chats out. At the minute, it's only individual chats using the chat feature, but they are going to extend it to pop out team conversations and pop out chats to do with meetings as well. But even this is a rather useful little tool to have. There's, again, being Microsoft, there's loads of ways of getting that. You can press it there, you can press it here, you can use the dot button and pop out chat, or you can actually just double click on the person and it pops the chat out onto a separate window. So if you use a multi-window setup, you can have multi-messages sitting tiled in another monitor, and then you can have your main meeting or anything else on here. So that is popping out. This button here allows you to add extra people to the chat. So that's setting up a group chat. So if you add people to this chat, initially it will be a new conversation. They don't actually bring, so if I added Rich to this chat, it would actually set up a brand new chat with Rich and Andy. At that point, if we added more people, Microsoft would give us the option to bring in either the last day, the last 7 days, all of the previous conversation, or a custom amount of time. Again, that's really useful, because I know if we're all in a WhatsApp group or in a Facebook group or whatever, and you get added after the start, somebody ends up having to forward all the messages to you or recopy and paste them in. So it gives you the option to drag that in. Chat's good in that way. Teams is better because it's persistent, but sometimes in your organization, you will have teams set up for departments and projects. The chat will be set up for smaller groups. So we'll talk about a bit more about that when we come to Teams as well. So that's all those. Files. We've got the paperclip down here, and it says to upload from OneDrive or upload from my computer. So that is your paperclip like you would have an email. Let me be clear though, you're not actually attaching it to it, you're actually sharing it. So if you know, if you've shared from Dropbox or if you've shared from OneDrive before, you're actually sharing. These tabs along the top allow you to look at the different parts of your conversation with this person. So with this, with files, what we've got is that button is more realistic. It is actually a share button. You're either sharing from your OneDrive at the minute or you're uploading it from your computer. When you upload it from your computer, it puts it into your OneDrive automatically and creates a share link. It is, again, that means that it's a consistent, persistent document. So if I open this test document and I edited it and saved it, or if Andy opened it, edited it and saved it, we would all have the latest version of that document. And from here, we can edit in Teams. We can open it in the browser, which is Word Online. But if you've got the desktop app, you can use that, obviously Word Desktop. And to be honest, if you're going to open it in the browser, you might as well just edit it in Teams. And we'll show that working when we come to Teams. So you can see here with download and get link, if you know anything about OneDrive, SharePoint, Dropbox, that sort of thing, the link is the sharing link as well. So everything that you have done back and forward with this person, message back and forward, and this becomes really useful when you're looking through your emails to find that attachment that somebody sent you 3 months ago and you can't find it. Well, just if you're on chat and you filed, shared it, what actually happens is all of them are here and you can group them by sent by or shared by, or the date shared. So that's chat. And quickly just show your phone. It's probably not integrated into your phone system, but it can be your voice over IP phone system. But this is where you can start calls, you can start group calls, you can start all of that. You can set up speed dials, you can set up new groups. So this is a voice over IP system anyway that you can use as well. On top of that, that means you can make calls from your mobile on the Teams app. Whether you've got an Android device, an Apple device, whether it's a tablet or a mobile phone, the Teams app on it is great and it's actually constantly getting better. It's probably about 95% of the features that you get on the desktop app. And so therefore, it's something really useful to have as well. You can have your voicemail and your contacts as well. So back up here a second. You can filter your chats. You can pin chats up here. If you notice, this one was pinned, so I could unpin it and repin different chats up here. And that allows me to be able to have my most important chat conversations up at the top. Let's have a quick look at the settings, and then we'll jump into Teams, and then we'll move on to meetings and video calls. You can actually set a status message. I find this rather useful. If I'm not available, I can actually say like an out of office reply. But and that appears, if you've noticed on Office 365 these days, if you're on Outlook and you put in somebody's email address and they've already got an out of office, It'll actually show up at the top of your email. Well, the same thing happens here. You can have it show up when people message me. So as soon as they actually type in your name on Teams, it will actually say this person isn't available. But you can also use the at symbol. The at symbol in Teams is used the same way as you would use it in Instagram or in Facebook or in Twitter. You mention someone or you mention a group or you mention that. So if I said I'm not available, contact Andy. All I would need to do is at Andy, and he then will be told that he's being referred to. So show it when people message me, and I'm going to clear it in 1 hour. So if I do that, it comes up there. It tells me that my status message will be shown in chat and channels when people message or mention me until 11:41. Don't worry about that. I'm actually based in Germany. That's where one of the other parts of Teams. So I'm 1 hour ahead. And if we go back to the message on chat, and we go back to chat feature here, Andy actually gets told that I've put it in. So if he's going, hey, hold on a second, I didn't agree to that, then he can deal with that as well. So let's jump over to Teams and talk about the difference between chat and Teams. Teams is your long-term, consistent, persistent conversations that you would do in Microsoft. So there's a few differences between chat and Teams. And let's talk about the first one. I want to talk about chat first, or the conversation, the posts that we've got here first. And then I'll come back to some of the other reasons why Teams exist in the way they do. One of the key things that Teams has over the chat is the fact that you can actually do inline replies. So if I look back up here, we've got 9 replies from Andy and me, mostly me because I've just been training on this and I've been showing Andy. So I can actually reply to this and I can say, hey, can we check this? I can go back as far as I want and converse, reply to something, reply to a chat, reply to somebody's part of a conversation. I've been on groups where there's been 34, 35, 36 different replies, and there's been lots and lots of people replying, and you can see who they all are and you can have a conversation. This takes out the need. You put a file in there, you put a comment in there, you put what would be an email in there, and instead of everybody doing a reply all, everybody can actually converse on it. Everybody can reply. Everybody can chat about something, make opinions. So you stop this constant email going back and forward about everything. You can still respond to each of them. You can see who's mentioned it. And you can even mention people in here as well. And if you're mentioned, what actually happens, it comes up on your machine and it actually has a mention button with it. So you will actually see, if I scrolled way up here, there's one where it actually has that's an announcement, but there's one above that which will actually have an at symbol, and that at symbol means that I was mentioned. I'd have to find it. So we've got that going on. What we also have on this is the fact that if you add somebody after the fact to a team, what happens is they see all of the conversation history. So you add a new person to your team, you add a new person to your project, they will be able to see everything that you've put in there. They can scroll back through it, they can talk about it, they can do all of that from it. Now, Teams are set up on a thing called Microsoft Office 365 Groups, which you might have ever seen before from Outlook. And what that basically means is that when a team is set up, you automatically get a shared notebook, a shared group of people, a shared team calendar, a shared file space, which is called SharePoint, and a shared email address. So when a team is set up or you create a team here, that's what happens. So all of those people are together in that group. It's kind of a Microsoft group. And that means that you can add people to it and remove people to it, and they will always be part of that group and they will see everything in it. So that's one of the other things. It's persistent and consistent. So when you're setting up teams, you're probably looking at having ones to do with either a certain project or department. And therefore, everybody can do it. You can have a company-wide team on Teams as well. So that's everybody in your organization, as long as you don't have more than 5,000 people. And then everybody can be in it. A couple of other things then to do with this is down here, we get the same stuff. We get the attachment, we get the emojis, we get the GIFs, we get the memes, we get all of those the same. But if I hit under the format, I get a few different things. And this becomes really useful as well. I can start a new conversation, which is great. And if I do it like that with a new conversation, I get a subject line like I would do in an email. And I can mention people as well. But I can also start put up an announcement. So that gives me more of a kind of bulletin. Hey everyone, this is just released. We need to read this document. And you can actually put a headline on there, important. You can change the background color or you can put your own image in there. You can decide whether people can reply or not. So if it's a company announcement and you don't want replies on it, or you know, it would just, you say, look, this is just an announcement, go to your channel to talk about it, you can do that. You can also post it in multiple channels. We'll talk about multiple channels in a minute, but it means that if you're across multiple teams and cross multiple channels, you can decide to post it in lots of those teams and lots of those channels. So that's a really useful tool to have that. I'm going to discard that. And if I scrolled up here, you might have seen before, there was one which had an announcement symbol at it. There we go. This is an announcement, just to make it really easy of what it is. So here's our team over here, the demo team that we're working on. If you've noticed, you might have noticed, we've got a demo team, then we've got different channels. The different channels are topics of conversation. So if you're doing a project, you might have an initialization phase, a design phase, a marketing phase, a sales phase, a feedback phase, and each of those would have their own channel. I've seen this used in multiple different ways. Different departments have different parts in here, different companies. So when you're setting up teams, you want to think about, do I need to create a new team or do I need to create a new channel? So you may actually have project A and then you're going to do project B. You can actually create a new team with the same people and then just start project B from it. Very, very quick look at managing of it. If you're in it, you can hide a team. You can add, if you own it, you can manage a team, add a channel, add a member. If your organization allows it, and if you're not sure how to do it, talk to Rich, but you can actually add external people. Now, obviously, when you add an external person to a team, it's the same idea as when you send somebody an email. If you're sending somebody an email and you're attaching something to it, you need to make sure you've put the right email address in. If you add an external person to a team, you need to make sure that what people are putting in there is relevant for them to see it. So if you've got the ability in your organization to do so, you will see that, add someone as a guest. And we've already got one guest up here, so it actually tells us at the top of it. To add channel, to create a team, you just do join or create a team, and it will ask you to either create a new one or take it from an existing Office 365 group. To add a channel, you can actually just give it a channel. Now with channels, you give it a name and a description, and then you get this option. You can have it accessible to everyone in that team or private only to a specific group of people. Now, if a specific group of people, that makes it a private channel. A private channel, only the people invited into it, because basically everybody can see everything in the team unless it's a private channel. So if you don't know, if you're not part of a private channel like this, you don't even see it. And this tells me it's padlocked. Hidden channels are just hidden, because I don't want to see them at the minute, because you might have far too many channels. You can also pin channels up to here to have your most important channels available. And as I said, Microsoft are coming to the point where they're actually going to be able to let you pop that out as well. I forgot to mention when I was in settings, because I jumped into that. Very quickly, under your settings here, you can actually do things like set up your voicemail under your calls. You can actually choose what devices you're using. Your voicemail actually transcribes any voicemails left of you. And the biggest part that you might want to play with if you start using Teams a lot is to actually deal with your notifications, because that allows you to decide whether you get lots of notifications or less notifications and where they come from. Some of them will actually go to your email. Other ones you can turn off entirely, like off. And when it talks about the feed, we're talking about this button, activity. So the activity is your feed. So there's a bit of a discrepancy there about the naming of it, but that's where you will see all your notifications coming. Just, I'll not show you how to do it because we don't have time today, but you can actually get the email address for each of your channels. And as you get the email address for each of your channels, you can actually send emails to that, or externally people can. Probably wouldn't want to do that because the email address is weird, but you could blind carbon copy emails into it and it appears in here, or you could set it up that emails get forwarded to Teams so that your whole team can see an email response. Let's have a quick look at files. If we do an attachment, it's the same idea as files here. Files on Teams are actually stored in SharePoint. If anybody has utilized SharePoint before, they'll probably see this menu at the top of your SharePoint window. And a couple of things here. You can actually set up new folders, new documents and everything from here. You can upload straight to Teams. You can sync to your desktop. If you sync to your desktop, everything that's in here becomes available on your File Explorer. So if I look here, that's open twice. If I look here, all of those files are here. So if I actually could work with them here, or I could open them up and I could save stuff to here, and it gets updated to Teams. I could view them online, I could view them in Teams, I can view them on my desktop. That will be, if you want to know more about OneDrive and SharePoint, that will be the course that we're doing a half hour on how to sync and how to deal with that. You can download them. You can, what this means though, is that everybody can see these documents. Everybody can work in these documents. Let's have a quick look at this document. I can actually could open this in SharePoint, but I'm actually just gonna quickly open it in Teams. And I can actually edit this actively live within my meeting. So I could be sitting in Teams and two of us could be editing this document at a time. Now, the version of the online version of Word that's available in Teams is not as good as your desktop app, but for doing basic edits and for general basic documents, it's perfectly fine. You do get a lot of the options under here. Excel, for example, still even does pivot tables in Teams now. So it's more if you want to go into the very, very fine detail of settings and margins and breaks and all that you need to actually open it in the desktop app. One of the other advantages here is you can actually have a conversation about the document while you're working on it. So you can actually open up the document and all of these replies that we talked about before, even the one that I put up here, have we checked this, are available here. And I can actually chat on it from here. Can we check this? So that's a really useful little tool as well. So that's how you can collaborate on Teams together on documents. One of the other things, though, that we've got up here is we've got other tabs. Not just documents, you can pin documents below as well, you can get version history. But up here we've got Teams training, we've got monthly stats, we've got IT. The monthly stats, all I did was I took one of the Excel files that we had there and I pinned it to the top, I made it a tab. So there's an option under the settings on files to make something a tab so you can get somebody to fill in an Excel spreadsheet live from within Teams. So that could be, please update once you log into this site. So that is available under the three dots, which is your menu option, and it's called Make It a Tab. But all our tabs that we see up here, we've got Teams Training, ITT. If I hit the plus button, this is where Microsoft comes into its own. Because not only have you got your consistent, persistent conversation chat on Teams, replies, inline replies, have that going on, you can actually attach all our document libraries, Excel, OneNote, PDFs, planners, which is a mini version of Project and a souped up version of your to-do list, Power BI. You can attach wikis to it, an FAQ type thing, OneNote, video, Visio Stream, which is Microsoft's video site, which is what actually happens with this video when we record it. It goes to stream and comes back automatically when it's rendered. SharePoint. You can also attach other things in. By the way, Forms is Microsoft's version of SurveyMonkey. And when you do that, you can have forms coming in or you can have people filling forms in from Teams. You can attach other things in, like you saw YouTube up there, so we could link in a YouTube video. You can put in Adobe Sign, you can put in other things like Power Apps, and this isn't the limit of it. If we look down here under apps, there's hundreds more, including, for example, you can launch your Zoom videos from within Teams. Just have a quick look up here. For example, Teams Training, we recorded a set of sessions of Teams Training. They're set up on stream. So all of our trainers, when they come in and they want to get refreshed on it, you can actually set up your training videos. Have it come through and available on Teams. People can watch them on their mobile. People can watch them on their desktop. It could be an induction set. It could be a training set. If I go down to the Affinity demo one here and I click on this here, Affinity, this is actually Affinity's website. You can link a website in. It's actually live and active. So if I click on any of the things in here, it will actually bring me to telecoms. So you don't actually have to leave Teams to do that. So if you need somebody to log into a site or follow through a process that's on a web page, they can do it from within Teams. Here's one that's connected to YouTube. So for example, a YouTube video that Affinity's got on their link to, I took the setting, I took the share link from it and I put it on here and that video becomes available from within Teams as well. I'm not going to go more into it because there's so much that you can actually spend time on any single part of it. The last thing that's down here before we jump into talking about meetings is Meet Now button. If you want, you can actually set up a meeting and say, we're all having a conversation here and you think, actually, it would be better if we actually had a video call. So you press the Meet Now button, you invite people in and anybody that's in that team can actually jump into that meeting. So that's a quick way. They're actually moving that button up to here because it's used so much. It hasn't quite moved yet, but it's in the cards to do. Quick look at calendar and the Teams. This calendar is synced with your Office 365 Outlook calendar, so anything in there will come through here. So if you want to do, you can do a Meet Now here. This is a Meet Now outside of a Teams channel. That means that when you do that, you can invite people into a meet now. If I did a new meeting, it would set up a schedule. I could add a title, new meet. Very simple, very similar to Outlook. Add an required attendee, and I can do that in. I can set my time. I can do repetition of it, recurrence, and I can add a channel. If I add a channel, it's like a provisional meeting for everybody in that channel. They all get notified about it, and they all get told that that meeting could take place. I'm going to set that meeting up, and you may end up having lots and lots of new meetings all the time. But let me show you something else. If you're an Outlook, it's here. Your Outlook calendar shows here as well. And you've also got the ability to actually set up a new Teams meeting from Outlook. And if you do it from Outlook, if you add new people to it, not everybody gets told about it. Only the people that you have updated or added or deleted gets told about it. And you've already got your meeting link here and you've already got your options. So you can actually take the link and send it to people separate. You don't even need to send them the invite. So that's what happened with this one that we did with you. You didn't actually get an invite from our calendar. You got the link sent through. Jumping back into the meeting, because we've got a few minutes left and I do want to cover it. We might actually go on by about a minute extra. Obviously, you can do your turn your camera on and off and mute on and off. We'll talk about screen sharing in a minute. You can now raise your hand in a meeting. And if you've got your participants, let me show you raising hand. If you do that, if it's a larger meeting, it comes up beside you that you've raised your hand and the person running the meeting gets told about it. It might run a bit slower because I'm actually sharing my screen as well. You've got your chat log here. That chat log becomes a persistent and consistent conversation around this team and around this meeting. So you can actually attach files in there. You can actually start a notebook in there. You can do a whiteboard in there, and it's all contained within that meeting. You can mute all the guests. You can actually remove somebody from a meeting by clicking on the three dots beside them. You can make them an attendee. Making someone an attendee means that they can't share their screen. They can't do their audio. They can't do their video. It's just more like a webinar. And you can actually change your settings on the fly. If you actually people have come into your meeting and they shouldn't have come into it, you can now do it from here. But your meeting options will always open on a page like this, a web page. Who can bypass a lobby? The default is only people in your organization, and they're actually going to add to that soon, only me. So you can have it that only you can come into the lobby and you invite everyone in. If you've got everyone for a webinar style, you want to make sure that you don't let everyone present. So that's the only thing you got to watch. So you may want to have an open link, so you're actually just inviting people in instead of having to have everybody's email address. But if that's the case, you either do people in your organization, specific people, or only you can present. Only your specific people means that everybody else is an attendee. So there's your settings there and that. Last, before I jump in and tell you some of the new features coming up, you can do your device settings. There's your meeting notes. You won't see these all because you're a guest in our tenancy. You can enter full screen. Show background effects now has obviously got the, as well as the effects, you've actually got add new. So you can put your own background in. You might have that on your computer if your computer doesn't have a certain graphics card. If you couldn't blur your background, you can't do this with it. You can turn on live captions, that's becoming better. You can start and stop recording, end the meeting, and you can turn off everybody's incoming video if there's too many, if your bandwidth isn't that good. When you share your screen, you get the option of just sharing the screen you're on or sharing your whole desktop or sharing a specific screen. Obviously, if you're sharing your whole desktop, please be careful of what's in the background in terms of privacy. But if you do that, that means that we can do things like show you start menu, go through things. Up here, this menu comes up. I could give control to someone else and I set it up that we can even do that externally. You can include system audio. So if you've got a video or a presentation to do, it allows you to actually play the audio on their machines rather than picking it up through your microphone. And you can stop presenting at any stage as well. Just a few things coming up from Microsoft. Microsoft have just said that they're moving to 49 on the screen up to. At the minute, they've got 3x3, which is 9. But as well as that, they're actually doing a few other things that they're actually making it dynamic so that if you actually can click on someone and they're sharing someone when you're on the screen, you can actually start a conversation with them on the screen. So that's just being talked about yesterday. The 49's been talked about before. That's coming over the summer and early autumn. They're also doing a virtual room. So if you don't want to have everybody with their own background, you can actually get everybody into a virtual room. And then it's like at the minute, they're going to do boardroom, but they've also got it like a lecture theatre where it takes an AI image of your face and the upper body, whatever torso showing on the screen, and puts that in a seat. And so it means it's a little bit more togetherness. So there's a whole lot of other things coming in as well with that. But yes, the big thing is the 49, because that's being changed with it. The difference between Teams and Zoom, and the reason it's taking them so long, is they need to look at their security on it. But actually, Teams doesn't listen in. Zoom software, not people, but Zoom software actually listens into your meeting. And what it does, it designates who's talking and puts their person on the main screen. Teams does not do that. All of that bit to work out who's speaking and whose video that they should put up and who should fill the 9 squares or the 49 squares is built into the Teams tenancy and built into the Teams software. So your data is secure from end to end. Obviously, if it's sitting on your own laptop and your laptop is not secure, it's not secured there, but they cannot listen to it and do not listen to it or have any software involved in it from end to end. And that's your data that's being shared. That's all your posts and your conversations, and that's all your video as well. And the last couple of things that they're bringing out, yeah, they brought out that, they brought out this. Oh, yes, they're upping the limit. They're going to have it that you can have 1,000 people in a meeting. And you can have, I think it's going to be 100,000 people available in live events. Because if you need more than, at the minute, 250, which is the current limit, you need a license which gives you a live event, which turns it into a full-on style webinar. But they're upping the limits on meetings to 1,000 later on this year. I'm sorry I've went a few minutes over. There is an awful lot of content that we need to get through at times. Let me also show you this button. Files allows you to see all your files that you've got on the machine, but it also connects to your OneDrive. It also connects to other cloud storage. So if you've got other cloud storage that you own, you can actually connect your Dropbox or your ShareFile or your Google Drive straight into here. Obviously, if you've got OneDrive, I don't know why you go for the other ones, but if you've got another account that somebody puts something into, you can access it through Teams, and that's where you see your other apps. I think I have now finished. I need to take a breath, and if anybody's got any questions or anything like that, we'd be happy to take them. It is a full-on whistle-stop tour. Teams and Zoom and other ones are apples and pears. This is more secure. This is more business-based. I use Zoom for things that aren't business-related, but primarily I use this for everything to do with business.